Pardon me, but I must ask you a question. Are you aware of how amazingly wonderful water is? Seriously, water is perhaps the most important substance on the planet Earth. It covers the majority of the Earth's surface. It makes up the majority of biological systems. In fact, without water, we probably wouldn't be here in the first place. Water is so important to life that most scientists agree that the presence of liquid water on the surface of a planet is an essential component of any planet that may house extraterrestrial life. But water is also really weird. Think about it. Water is one of the few substances that can exist on the planet Earth as a solid, a liquid, and a gas under normal conditions. Water is also one of the few substances whose solid form, ice, floats on its liquid form. What's that all about? Well, in this video, we'll talk about all the wonderful, amazing properties of water and the chemical basis for those properties. So stay tuned while I quench your thirst for knowledge about water. Thanks for tuning in. Today we're going to be talking all about water. Why? Because water is perhaps the most important substance on the planet Earth. It covers the majority of the Earth's surfaces and makes up the majority of biological systems. And as such, water dictates the way most biological systems operate. And that's because of its many unique characteristics. But before we start talking about all those unique properties of water, first we're going to talk about the chemical basis for those properties. So let's start that conversation by reminding ourselves of what water actually looks like. Remember that water is formed through polar covalent bonds. It's formed through a single oxygen atom bonded to two hydrogen atoms. And because of their electronegativity differences, the electrons that are shared between the oxygen atom and the two hydrogen atoms are shared slightly unequally. The result is that the oxygen atom spends a little bit more time with those shared electrons than the two hydrogen atoms do. This results in a slightly weak negative charge forming around the oxygen side of the molecule, whereas around the hydrogen atoms, you get weak positive charges. This is what we call a dipole. Slightly negative charge around the oxygen atom and slightly positive charges around the hydrogen atoms. But this bent shape allows water to behave in a certain way. Because of its bent shape, water is able to form hydrogen bonds. Now, again, you may remember we've talked about this in a previous video, and if you haven't, you can go check that video out. Hydrogen bonds are weak intermolecular interactions that occur between polar covalent molecules. And this gives rise to the first property of water that we'll talk about, cohesion. Cohesion is the property of water molecules to stick to themselves. Because water has a positive pole and a negative pole, water molecules are able to interact with each other and sort of stack on each other, not unlike we observe with ionic bonding. It doesn't have the strength of an ionic bond, but it does have the ability to stick to itself. And this is why if you put a bunch of water together, it'll form droplets. That's the cohesive property of water, water sticking together. But this gives rise to something else. Because water molecules are stuck to each other through hydrogen bonds, in order for water to get heated up, in order for water molecules to start moving, those bonds have to be broken. And this brings us to another key characteristic of water. Water as a substance has a relatively high heat capacity. Now, if you remember what temperature is a measure of the kinetic energy of a substance. It's a measure of how much energy of movement those molecules have. Now, because in water, water molecules are held together through hydrogen bonds, in order to make those molecules move faster, you have to provide enough energy to break those hydrogen bonds between the molecules. What that means is a lot of energy has to be put into water in order to increase its temperature. That is what heat capacity is. But why is that important for biological systems? Well, for starters, it means that biological systems, which are made up of a majority of water, are able to resist temperature changes to a certain extent. but it also impacts life from the planetary perspective. Large bodies of water retain a fair amount of heat, and this drastically impacts climate and weather. So think about this. If you live in a coastal region, you tend to have slightly cooler temperatures in the summer and slightly warmer temperatures in the winter than if you were to live in inland areas. I'll give you an example. Compare the relatively landlocked Montreal, Quebec in Canada to the relatively coastal region of the country of England. Now, if you look in terms of latitude, they are approximately the same latitude north of the equator, which means you'd expect them to have the same climates. However, because England is bathed in oceanic waters that come from the Caribbean Sea, England stays a lot warmer throughout the year than Quebec. But this ability of water molecules to hydrogen bond to themselves also explains something else. It also explains why ice is less dense than water. So if you think about the kinetic energy of a substance, you think about the motion of those water molecules in liquid water, what that allows is it allows those molecules to sort of bump up against each other and then move past each other. They're allowed to sort of violate what we call bond distance. Most of the time, things have to stay a certain distance apart from one another. That's what hydrogen bonding controls. But if you provide enough energy for those molecules, they can sort of brush past each other. Picture liquid water being kind of like a busy mall or a busy town square. If there are hundreds of people packed together, you may brush by somebody. But if you're forced to stay in place, you'll kind of create your own sort of personal space where you wouldn't necessarily be bumping up against somebody or brushing up against somebody. That's what happens to the molecules in water as they begin to cool. When water is warm, when it's in the form of steam or in liquid water, those molecules can sort of brush up against each other, then move away. They violate what we would call the hydrogen bonding distance. But as water begins to cool, they begin to get sort of locked in. And when they're locked in, they start to stack on each other, not unlike the cations and the anions in a crystal lattice, like we see in an ionic substance like salt. In the end, what ends up happening is the water molecules settle farther apart when they're in their static, frozen, icy state than they are when they're in their liquid state or their gaseous state. And the end result then is that ice is less dense than liquid water. This allows ice to float. Now you may think, hey, that's great. That means that I can put ice in my glass and the ice will float to the surface and so on and so forth. But the importance of this is way more significant than that. Think about lakes, ponds, oceans. What would happen if ice sank? If ice sank, every winter, a sheet of ice would form on the surface as the temperature cooled and then fall to the bottom. But every year, a little more ice would fall to the bottom, and then eventually you'd end up with this huge stack of ice at the bottom of the oceans or the bottom of lakes or the bottom of ponds and a very, very thin layer of liquid water that might melt during the summer, then refreeze. How could life exist in a state like that? And the answer is it couldn't. So if ice were more dense than liquid water, the planet Earth would not exist as we know it. And as a result, life probably would never have formed in the first place. Hydrogen bonding also explains water's adhesive properties. Adhesion is the ability of water molecules to stick to other things and surfaces. So, for example, if you put water on the surface of a leaf or on your skin, it tends to stick there. It also allows water to stick to other substances, which we'll get to in a moment. But if you combine the cohesive and the adhesive properties of water, you end up with another characteristic of water called capillary action. Capillary action refers to the ability of water to sort of climb up narrow tubes. Now you can see from this drawing what capillary action kind of looks like in a laboratory where you have a tiny little capillary, a little straw sticking in the water, and you can see the level inside the straw is slightly higher than the surrounding water. But the implications for life are way more important than that. Think about plants. Plants have no muscles, but plants need to be able to move water from their deepest roots to the tallest portion of their shoots. And for something like moss, that's not a huge deal. In fact, for something like a dandelion, that's not a huge deal. But let's look at a great redwood standing hundreds of feet high. They have to be able to move water from their deepest roots up to the tallest branch on that tree. And how do they do it? It's simple, through capillary action. What ends up happening is water sticks to hydrophilic, which are water-loving parts of the plant, inside of its xylem. As that water begins to climb, because it's also cohesive, it drags other water molecules up behind it. Water then slowly climbs throughout the entire trunk of that tree or the stem of the plant until it gets to its uppermost surface. Without this property of water, plants could never exist, particularly land plants could never exist. And as we'll cover in a later video, without land plants, we don't have land animals. Without land animals, we don't have land humans. The other interesting part about the adhesive property of water is that it lends water its ability to function as an amazing solvent. Now, if you remember, a solvent is a substance that can dissolve another substance, which we would call a solute. And water is the solvent of life. Because all biological systems consist of a water-based solution, the ability of other substances to interact with water is crucial to understanding how biological systems exist. Now remember that water is a polar covalent substance. And as such, water is amazingly awesome at dissolving what we would call polar substances. Water is great at dissolving other polar covalent molecules. It's also great at dissolving ionic solutes as well, things like salts. And the reason why is simple. Remember those partial charges that water molecules have, the partial positives on the hydrogen, the partial negatives on the oxygen. Well, when something that has partial charges or whole charges, like the cations and anions that make up an ionic compound, enter into an aqueous solution, one that contains water, those water molecules coat those molecules or ions that come into the solution and shield them, hiding their charges. For example, if we're looking at sodium chloride, the partially negatively charged regions of the water molecules will help to shield the positive charge of the sodium cation. Whereas the partially positive charges around the hydrogen pole of the water molecules will shield the negatively charged chloride anions. On the other hand, there are other substances that we refer to as being hydrophobic. So things that like water, things that are easily to dissolve in water, things like salts are what we call hydrophilic, water loving. Things that don't like water, won't dissolve well in water, things like oils, for example, are what we call hydrophobic. These are things that don't dissolve well in water, water fearing. So what does that have to do with life? Well, because everything in a cell, for example, has to be dissolved in an aqueous solution, there are some major implications. For example, if we look at a molecule like a phospholipid, which makes up all biological membranes, phospholipids have one end that's hydrophilic and is positively charged, and one end that is hydrophobic, that doesn't like water. We call it the hydrophobic tail. Well, if you look at the structure of a biological membrane, it's structured in a way where the polar charged heads are facing the aqueous portion, either outside or inside the cell, whereas the hydrophobic tails come together in the middle. That happens automatically. And the reason why is the way those phospholipids interact with the water. The water-loving hydrophilic heads like to face outward into the water, whereas the hydrophobic tails run for the middle and give biological membranes their properties, which we'll talk about in another video. It also drastically impacts the way proteins function. And we'll learn that proteins' shape is essential for their function. So if proteins don't fold up properly, if they don't take the right three-dimensional shape, they can't do their jobs, which are essential for all living things. Proteins are made out of little tiny things called amino acids that come together to form a large protein. Well, some amino acids are hydrophilic and some are hydrophobic. You can see in this drawing that the ones that are hydrophilic are labeled in blue, whereas the ones that are hydrophobic are labeled in red. And outside of water, this protein may have no unique shape to it whatsoever. It's just kind of a mess. But the minute you put it in water, it begins to take shape. And the reason why is those hydrophilic blue amino acids begin to face the water. They start to dissolve and get shielded by the partial charges on the water molecules. Whereas those that are hydrophobic begin to run towards the middle. They begin to fold inwards and exclude themselves from the water. And this helps to give proteins their unique three-dimensional shape and thus their function. Another major issue surrounding the ability of water to act as a solvent is something called pH. Some salts that dissolve in water are called acids, while others are called bases. Acids are those substances that when they dissolve in water, release something called hydronium ions. It's basically water plus an extra proton, an extra H, call it H3O+. Bases, when they enter into a solution and they dissolve in water, they release hydroxide anions. It's basically an oxygen and a hydrogen. It's basically a water molecule missing one of its hydrogens. The concentration of those H3O pluses, of those hydronium cations, is what reflects as pH. Now, pH can range based on that concentration from 1 to 14, with pHs of 1 being the most acidic and pHs of 14 being the most basic. But here's the thing about biological systems. Biological systems are exquisitely sensitive to pH, and they must regulate their pH. Remember, one of the key characteristics, one of the key properties of life, regulation. And this is where it comes into play. So how do biological systems regulate their pH? And the answer is through the use of special acids and bases that are called buffers. Buffers are weak acids and the conjugate base that they form when they dissolve in water, or weak bases and the conjugate weak acid that forms when they dissolve in water. But what's really interesting about buffers is they're what we call reversible reactions. They can kind of go in both directions. And they're subject to something called the law of mass action. What that means is if you put a little bit more of one thing on one side of that chemical equation, the reaction goes the other way to balance that out. So for example, if we have a chemical reaction, if we have a buffer in one of our cells and we add a little bit more acid, it shifts that equilibrium, it shifts that reversible reaction over to make a little bit more base, resulting in a net zero change of pH. Or if we add a little bit of base, it shifts back the other way, resulting in, again, a net change of zero in pH. These buffers help to maintain the pH of our cells, the pH of our tissues, and the pHs of all living things to help them survive. So I hope you guys learned a lot today. I hope you learned about all the weird, wonderful properties that water has and how those are the direct result of the polar covalent bonds that form the water molecule that allow for hydrogen bonding, and how hydrogen bonding contributes to all of those distinct properties. I hope you also learned that without water, life on this planet would never have existed in the first place, nor would it have ever evolved into the amazing menagerie that we see today. So thanks for tuning in, and I look forward to seeing you next time. Until then, stay thirsty for knowledge.